From the End Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. This stream is totally unannounced, unprepared. However, I felt like, let's do this. Because what is this stream about? It is about my workflow. But before we dive into that, let me introduce myself quickly for those of you who don't know who I am. My name is Mixmaster G. I'm a 54-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15. So you are looking at almost 40 years of real life DJ experience in the flesh. I'm no longer an active DJ. I don't play clubs, festivals, etc. anymore. I leave that to the younger generation. Of course, I do it incidentally, but it's not like I'm doing it every month or every week or whatever. It's more like every now and then. However, a DJ heart never dies, which means I'm still active with music. And like I said in the introduction, I try to share my knowledge that I obtained over the years as a DJ with other DJs so they can do their own benefit with it. I'm well known for developing apps. One of the apps I've developed is the DJ conversion utility that allows you to convert from whatever DJ software into other DJ software, maintaining your cues, loops and other DJ metadata. But I developed much more tools. And that is what this workflow video is about, because all these tools originated from my own workflow. It is not like I thought, all right, let's make a bunch of money creating an app that will sell millions. No, I just thought about, all right, I'm doing this stuff, but I'm doing the same stuff each week over and over when I introduce new tracks to my collection. How can I make this the most efficient and most robust way to make sure that the end result will always be the same? And that is where my apps came from. First, let me establish the base, what I go to work from. I have downloaded some tracks from my various record pools. I already prepared some of this because part of this can be pretty boring. So I already did prepare some tracks, others I didn't. I'm going to introduce those tracks to my iTunes collection, and my iTunes collection is the base for everything, which means iTunes is the base for basic collection management, for making playlists, for setting DJ metadata, artist, title, artwork, year, etc. Then I forced myself to set star ratings for every track that I introduce to my collection, because I quickly saw that, all right, I download like 50 tracks a week, I throw them into my collection, and of those 50 tracks, 48 tracks, I don't know what they are about. I have no idea, I have no clue. And I thought that's entirely wrong. That's not how a DJ is supposed to work. So I said to myself, all right, it's okay to introduce tracks to your collection, but at least you have skipped through them and you've given them a star rating. So that is my way of forcing myself to listen to each track. My star rating is not how much I like a track. My star rating is an indication of how likely is it that I'm going to play a track in a set. So the star rating works as follows. 3 stars is neutral. I might play it, I might not play it. 2 and 1 star is not likely at all. 4 stars likely, 5 stars very likely. So you get the idea. And those stars are dynamic. I can change them in iTunes, and that means that I change them automatically in all DJ software that derive their playlists from iTunes, which are basically every DJ software I use. So that's the base. iTunes is the base. Then about storing my tracks. My tracks are stored on an external AppleShare file server. For those of you who think that's too technical for me, it is just a big external drive that is part of my network. Think about it that way. Reason for that is that the file path to my tracks is always the same, no matter which computer I work on. And I've got a bunch of computers I work on. This computer you are watching right here, I'm working on right here, is a Mojave computer. It runs Mojave, that means it runs iTunes. But I've got a Big Sur M1 computer in my network. Behind me is an Hysera computer that runs Traktor DVS with the SL1200s with it. I've got in the living room and in the house, I've got several computers. So there are a lot of computers that use the same tracks all over because they are stored on the file server in my network. That is about the basic collection management. Once the tracks are in iTunes then and have their star ratings, then I'm going to introduce them to Traktor. Traktor is my base DJ software. Now, for those of you who think, hey, I'm not using Traktor, I use Serato, I use Virtual DJ, it doesn't matter what you use. Because my workflow, you can apply to basically any DJ software you like. Traktor just happens to be my base, and the reason for that is basically twofold. The first and biggest reason is I am a Traktor user since it first came out. That was back in 2000. So I'm 21 years a Traktor user already. And that makes it feel like home to me. I know everything about Traktor. I can use it in every way I like. So that's why I stick to Traktor. To make things even worse, I bought a complete Nexus 2 rig, which is right in front of me. You see it right here. This is my, I call it Audio Hub. This is CDJ2000 Nexus 2, a DJM900 Nexus 2 mixer, and another 2000 right there, Nexus 2. But that is not visible because the laptop is in front of it. But those are mainly used as controllers in Traktor because there is still no good full jog wheel size or full sized jog wheel controller for Traktor anymore. So that is why I had to invest in this stuff. Next to it is Denon Prime gear, which is my preferred performance platform. So you can see I use kind of everything around here, and that is what this workflow is all about. How you can set up a base, and for me that base is iTunes for basic collection management, and then Traktor for my DJ preparations, and from there on out I'm going to convert to everything. I'm going to convert to Serato, to Virtual DJ, to Algorithms DJ, even on iOS, to my Prime rig. And you will see that this is going to be a very efficient way. Once things are set up, it is just pushing a few buttons, sitting back and waiting until it's finished. And that is exactly the reason why I created this workflow the way I did. Because I hate double work and double labor, especially with collection management, because it can be boring as hell. And that is the reason why I do this. During this whole stream, the chat will be open for all your questions you may have that are related to collection management and conversion. So you can just throw it in the chat and I'm happy to answer it. I'm notorious for not switching my cams. I've got a bunch of cams set up here. But the problem is when I'm in the workflow, or actually in a flow or in a stream flow, I'm just watching the screen straight in front of me. And sometimes I forget that I have to switch my camera view in order for you guys to see it too. If that's the case, just drop it in the chat, view or cam or whatever. And I'm going to switch it back. So that is how this stuff works. So first up, let me switch that camera like this. And let me put myself a little bit lower because I see I'm a little bit high right there. Let's do it like this. Let's see. There we go. I got hair, as you can see. Let's put it a little bit like this. So I got two shoulders too. There you go. That should do the trick for now. Oh, that's not what I want. This is what I want. All right, so this is the view you are going to watch most of the time. This is my iTunes collection, and this time around we are in my complete iTunes collection. Let me get it off repeat here, and let me take it out. So you can see right here that we are talking about a collection of almost 112,000 tracks. Let's face it, I'm not going to carry 112,000 tracks to a gig. Actually, I do. But that is not what you're going to spin with. Usually you spin with like 1200 tracks max, and you choose of course from that. So my collection is divided. And how is it divided? Well, here you see my main playlists. The most important ones for me are the ATDR necessities, which are playlists that basically contain all my necessities I want to have in a rig. And you can see right there at the titles what it is. A bunch of acapellas, a bunch of dance mixes, stuff I created my own remixes, which are called probeersels. Probeersel is Dutch for try out, somehow. Outros, starters, bangers, you name it. And then the genre selected playlist. So basically that is how I, what my necessities folder is. And when I'm spinning, I'm mostly working out of that necessities folder, because those are the tracks, and if you look at it, it's like 4,000 tracks, 3,400 tracks that are really my big tracks. Then we've got what is called the dance related collections, and here this one is the most interesting one, dance EDM by ear. These are big playlists. And those big playlists basically contain all tracks that are dance related, but not in the top 40. So these are the extended versions, the special versions, or things that never made it to the commercial hit parades, however, still are useful in sets. So let's say things you buy on Beatport, for instance, end up in the dance collection. Lately, I'm dividing that into subs, as you can see, hardstyle, house, all kind of stuff. So I'm lately dividing that a little bit more than just one big playlist, but basically it is still a big playlist. And that is where I already did put some stuff in, so I'm going to dive into that later. Hey Craig Perry, welcome to the stream, my friend. This is just an unprepared, totally random Jesse stream I'm doing right now, Craig Perry, but feel free to hang around and stick around if you like, and ask questions if things are not completely clear. My last important lists are here, the top 40 collections by year, and that's basically exactly what it says. It are the top 40 collections by year, and you can see right here we've got the 2021 by year. And this is the reason why I'm doing this stream, because if I do it, I sort it at date edit. You see that the last time I did add tracks to it was April 5th, and today is May 23, which means I'm a little bit behind. So that is the reason why I'm doing this stream. I'm going to add a shitload of top 40 tracks to the top 40 list, and then some I already prepared. More about that later. So that is quickly how I lay out my iTunes playlist, and again, once the stuff is in there, it is written in stone. What is important about this is that you manage your tracks yourself, that you store your tracks yourself. So if I go to my iTunes preferences, and this is the number one reason why things go bad if DJs use iTunes. If you let iTunes manage your track, that means you've got those things on. Keep iTunes media folder organized and copy files to the iTunes. If those are on, it is a disaster in the making, because then things can seriously go wrong. That's the reason why they are off in my collection. So I am in charge of where I store my tracks. And because my playlists are leading, are dictating what is important, it doesn't matter where those tracks are really stored. So in general, I just roughly store it by year. And let me have a look with you right here. You see the terabyte drive. That is that AppleShare file server, that central networked drive, if you like, where everything is stored. And if I open it up, you will see that we've got the dance dossier collection. That is where the tracks from the dance by year are coming from. And right here, you've got the 2021 folder, for instance. You can see that it holds 938 tracks. That's just this. I just dump it in. I really don't care put it by genre or to put it anything else. I just dump it in that big folder because iTunes is my guide. In iTunes, I decide what is important to see in playlists. If I'm going to do that on the folder level, then it becomes a complete disaster the moment I just transfer to a different drive. And like this, it really doesn't matter because my playlists are leading here. The same if you look at top 40. That is right here, top 40 collection. If you open it up, you got each year has a top 40 year. And if you open it up, we've got 138 items in the top 40 right now. And that is where we are going to add stuff to. Now, the number one thing in a DJ collection you don't want are duplicates. Duplicates are dead in the DJ collection, because if you have a track that is a duplicate, and you had only one of those duplicates having the cues, and you load up the wrong track in your deck, you don't have cues, or it has not been analyzed, or it doesn't have key information, so you don't want duplicates in your collection. In the past, of course, storage was an issue. You don't want duplicates because they eat up double storage. Well, with the price of storage these days, that is not an issue, but duplicates are an issue if you look at the metadata. You want to make sure that there is only one single track of Billie Jean by Michael Jackson that you use, and that has the proper cues and loops and grid, etc. And not that you load a Billie Jean by Michael Jackson in the deck and to find out that it doesn't have any stuff set. So that is the reason why it is so important to do it like this. Mr. Pass. Well, that depends on the kind of DJ you are. The question is how beneficial I do find it to organize by year. Like I just showed, my storage is organized by year. So I have basically three segments. I've got stuff I produced myself. I don't care when I produce it, I put a year in, or remixes I made myself. I just drop it in one big folder. Then I've got commercial top 40 stuff. I just store it by year, and then I've got dance stuff. That is basically all tracks that are you buy from Beatport, etc., that didn't make it to the commercial charts, but you still want to keep on your system. Those are stored by year as well. So year is basically my guide for this. But you will see in this workflow that I store indeed by year, that I add by year, but that I go over the year if a track, let's say a track is introduced in the top 40 in November, that usually means that if it is a hit, that it's still in the top 40 in January or even February the next year. And usually if you are very strict with keeping tracks in the year folder when they are a hit, that you get duplicates. So that can carry over. So it is possible that tracks from February 2021 are stored in the top 2020 folder because they were introduced in 2020. And even we all know if an artist passes away, like for instance, David Bowie passed away, was a recent example. That man had hits in the 80s and those were re-released when he passed away. Let's Dance was a hit when he passed away again. And then I just fall back to the storage of the original track. So it all kind of depends, but I find year very important. I find the distinction between remixes I made myself, dance stuff, so good dance stuff, but not necessarily commercial, and commercial stuff very important. So yes, that is important, I think, Mr. Pass, to answer your question there. But let me show you how this stuff works. So I've got right here the music stuff. This is the folder where the stuff is being introduced when downloaded. And you can see right here that I am a little bit past behind because I've got Tipper 8 and I've got Top 40. You can see starting from week 15 to week 21. So that is how much I was behind. And those folders just contain tracks. This is my download folder. This is not my final storage folder because my final storage folder is on the terabyte Top 40 collection. This is my final storage folder. So to the left, you've got what I've downloaded, and to the right, you've got the Top 40 2021 folder that is going to be the final destination. And the big question, of course, is, all right, how do I get... Oh, hold on, I'm not switching my screen again. Sorry, folks, here we are again. So here, this is the stuff I just downloaded, and this is the final destination folder it needs to be in. And the big question is, of course, how do you get that stuff that is in the left window, in this window, without any duplicates, because it is overlapping. Each week, I take from my record pool the new entries, new binnenkomers is new entry in the tipper rate and in the top 40. So when a track comes into the tipper rate, it can the next week go to the top 40, meaning that that same track is going to be a duplicate. And you want to filter all that out and you want to make sure that it is not already in your collection. I made an app for that. And that app is called the iTunes Collection Tool, ICT for sure, for short. So this is going to be the first app that I'm going to use today in the workflow. Let me power it up. And what this app will do is basically take care of all the manual labor involved in introducing tracks to my iTunes collection. This app will copy the track to the correct folder. It will check my iTunes collection if it is already in the iTunes collection. And the criteria for duplicate here are an audio fingerprint, so it doesn't look at tags, it doesn't look at artist or title, no, it looks at the audio data, an audio fingerprint, and the length of a track. If the audio fingerprint and the length of the track already are in my collection, then it knows it is a duplicate. And it will not edit. It will add the already existing part to the playlist. So that is basically what is going to happen here. I click on the add new tracks and you get this dialog. And here I'm going to fill in some stuff. First of all, I just drop in this folder because that is the folder that is I'm going to work with. It will automatically scan the subfolders with all the tracks it contains to make sure that all those tracks are there. So I will open just some subfolders here, so you can see that happening in a moment, that it will automatically reduce them to zero when it's done like this. So let's take that there and just keep it in the back so you get an idea of what is going on there. Then the next thing is I want to tell it in which playlist it has to add the tracks. So let's select those playlists. And this is going to be the Top 40 2021 playlist. And the moment I do that, it automatically recognizes, all right, that's the Top 40 2021 playlist. That means that it is linked to the Top 40 2021 collection on the terabyte. So it knows, because I used it in the past, which folder is going to be the final folder. So All those tracks are going to be copied from the left window to the right window automatically. And if a track is duplicate, it will store them in a folder named Dubs that is also on the terabyte. Let me show that to you, which is basically right here. And you can see it contains 2600 tracks, which is basically a pre-trash bin folder. All the tracks here are not in my collection. I'm not interested in. They were deemed duplicates by the ICT tool in the past. So that is just something that I need to empty, but I want to make ICT to be as safe as possible, which means it will not trash files directly. It will move them to that dubs folder, and then from that dubs folder I can manually trash them if I want to, and I do that each and every time, whenever it is necessary. I click the start healing button here, and then it's just a matter of sit back and enjoy the ride, because this is on full automatic and you can immediately see the benefits of this. 81 tracks are going to be processed here, and it will automatically copy them, it will check if they are in the collection, and then it will add them to that playlist. So this is going to save me a huge amount of time, which is exactly the idea behind my tools. Save yourself time for the fun stuff. It's like talking to you guys, because right now this can take a moment to be processed. And after that, we should be good to go. So the tracks are moved over. The finder can be slow, by the way, to process this stuff. So usually you see that it takes some refresh, because I use very special routines to copy that stuff over. So it is already all copied over from the left to the right window. However, the finder doesn't realize that. That is the reason why I do it like this. Mr. Paz, I was a bit late, so I apologize if you have said this, but can you confirm, is the terabyte the main folder your DJ software reads? Yes, Mr. Paz, that is correct. That is my AppleShare file server. That is the central computer in my network. However, an AppleShare file server works like an external drive. So see it as a big external network drive. And that is indeed what all my DJ software uses, but also all my other computers in my network. So this computer is my main production rig. So I set the queues here, I make my playlists here, and from here on out I distribute that information to all other computers, and they can just use it, and they all use the tracks on the terabyte. So indeed, you correctly got it, completely correct. That is what is the centerpiece of my storage for tracks, and that is also what I need to backup. So that makes life a little bit easier, because all I need to do is just backup that terabyte and then it will work. And in the past, in my regular Ask Me Anything streams, I've shown that, for instance, I can unmount the terabyte and mount an external backup drive named terabyte to the computer, and that computer don't mind. It just thinks, all right, I can see the tracks, I can load them. That's one of the beauties of being on the macOS system. We use drive names instead of drive letters, and those drive names are static. So if your drive name remains the same, your Mac can find the tracks. We are all done. That means that all these folders are now empty, and you can see they are indeed all empty. The new tracks are right here. How do we know? Let's do it like this. Always a little bit hard to find which one are there. However, I'm going to make things a little bit easier, because we are going to iTunes. They were introduced to iTunes to the 2021 playlist. And if we say date on date edit sorted, you can see right there, they are there. And you can see, for instance, that this purple disco machine, while it was still added, has some stars. That indicates to me that that track was already in the collection. However, the version in my downloaded tracks, the version I just got from the record pool, was of a better quality than the one that was already existing. So what happens then is the existing one will be replaced with the better quality one. However, the metadata of the older one will be projected on the new track, on the just downloaded track. So there is a shitload of intelligent stuff going on behind the scene in ICT, and I can think spent a complete evening talking about it, what it all does. It is by far the most complex piece of software I've ever written, I can say that. But it is true magic what it does. All good, I think, and it is easy for me to see what was introduced new and what wasn't. Right here you can see the diversion between April the 5th and May the 23rd today. So basically all this stuff is newly introduced to my collection. From those 81 downloaded tracks, a total of 56 unique tracks is introduced to my collection. And like I said, the next step is set star ratings for those tracks. And that is just something I told myself, I'm going to do this. I'm going to set star ratings because I want to make sure that I have skipped through a track. Now, setting star ratings in iTunes is a manual thing. So I made this automatic. With the iTunes collection tool you saw me just using, come a shitload of scripts that that make it possible to use keyboard shortcuts. I use a program named Quicksilver, you can see that right there, to launch those keyboard shortcuts. Quicksilver itself is not what is containing the scripts. The scripts are in ICT, are mine, but Quicksilver is just a script launcher, you can say, so you can assign key combinations to launch certain scripts, and that's what it does. And that's exactly what I'm going to use right here. Now, I'm going to move back the audio a little bit because I don't want to be struck by any copyright strikes, because this is also streamed to YouTube and Facebook. What you will see me do is basically skip through the track very quickly and then give it a star rating. And that star rating is given by just a key combination. Command 1 for 1 star, command 2 for 2 stars, command 3, command 4, command 5. Once a star is assigned to a track, it will skip to the next track automatically and starts playing that track. So I don't have to use the mouse at all. You will see that the mouse, let me put that right here. The mouse will stay there. I'm not going to use any mouse at all yet to start the track. I can even do that by pressing enter, and then all will be automatic. So it's like this. Let me.
Kom niet ineens.
Alright, so I just went very quickly through that. All the tracks have their stars. Usually, This is my top 40 list, and my top 40 list, all tracks remain. Because when I'm making, for instance, year mixes, I just want access to those tracks. In my dance part, so the tracks I've downloaded from Beatport, for instance, sometimes I give 2 stars, and after I assign the stars, I immediately remove them from the collection. Everything below 3 will be removed from the collection because odds are 0 that I would ever use those tracks. Mr. Paz is asking me, how many tracks do I have in your collection? Well, right now, let me show that to you, is 111,000 tracks. But like I already said at the beginning, these are not all the tracks I'm going to use. My ATGR necessities folder is my go-to folder, is my base of operation, usually with top 40 around the years folders. And that is just a mere 3,300 tracks. So the reason why my collection is this big is because I like to make remixes. So sometimes I like to use samples from tracks which I not necessarily like myself, but I like to use those tracks. I like to include them in a remix. So that's the reason why they are on my system. Or in the very unlikely event that you get a request that you don't have in your regular folders, then all right, it's fine to have a very big collection. But I always say, all right, somebody who is interested in coins has a coin collection. Somebody who's interested in stamps have a stamp collection, and a DJ is interested in music, so they have an audio collection, period. But that is a difference between what is in my collection and what I do need in order for a successful gig. So those are two entirely different entities. Those are worlds apart from each other. However, they overlap, and I have to admit that these days I'm more and more falling back and see myself using online streaming services like BeatSourceLink and BeatPortLink. I can spend an entire evening about those services as well. But I really think that is going to be the future for DJing. And like it or not, it is just the logical next evolutionary step. After we were on vinyl, we went to CDs, we went to MP3s. I think the next step is going to be streaming service, like it or not. And of course you can say, yeah, but what if my Wi-Fi is down, and what if there is no internet at the site? Trust me, every site that you are going to play your gig will have internet access. It just needs to have it, if only for the Instagram selfies and stuff like that. So that will be there no matter what. What I did right now is I just introduced the tracks to my base iTunes collection. And like I said, iTunes is my base of operandi for my collection management, and Traktor is my DJ software that I use. Yeah, wireless DJ, I know DuckScript indeed, and they do have a lot of very interesting tools. However, the problem with DuckScript is that they are just for general iTunes use. But if you want to develop your own tools, DuckScript is very, very interesting as a source of information. They have very useful information, that is simple for sure. And they have very tools, but like what you just saw with ICT, you cannot do that with the DuckScript because it is not just AppleScript that is used. There is a lot of stuff being used. For instance, the audio fingerprinting part alone, you cannot do that in AppleScript. Another problem with AppleScript, and AppleScript is used by all my tools, by the way, so I'm not against AppleScript. I fully embrace it. But AppleScript and iTunes, or the music app, have the following problem. iTunes doesn't execute AppleScript command sequentially. So it doesn't, if you send a command to iTunes from an AppleScript, it doesn't necessarily immediately execute that command. And it doesn't execute, if you send multiple commands, the commands in the sequence you sent them to. And that is really a big problem with iTunes. You always have to make sure that the command you have sent to iTunes is executed before you send the next command. Otherwise, things can be messed up. And that can be, for instance, you can say, let's make a new folder, let's put 5 tracks in it, let's make a second folder and put 5 tracks in it. But it can put 5 tracks in the main collection before it puts them in the folder, because it didn't create a folder yet, because it's not sequentially doing all the things you tell it to do. So that is one of the problems if you are not very technically aware. But DocScript is, of course, a very useful site, and I can fully recommend it, as I can recommend everybody to just dive into what AppleScript can do. All my tools use AppleScript as their foundation. So usually AppleScript is the container, is the over, is the big app that contains all the other code. My tools are also written in Python, in Object-C. I just use whatever is easy for me to use and makes sense for me to use. I try to make everything as modular as possible, not only as tool-wise, but also inside, so I can very easy just mess around with the code. All right, we have now in iTunes this information, but I want to have that information in Traktor. And Traktor is notorious for not playing nice with iTunes or with any other collection, simply. So in order to get this information into iTunes, I need, or in Traktor, I need to do some steps. And also, I made a tool for that. But before I do, I first want to do something else, and that is the following. You see this folder named dump, which is basically what it says. It is my scratch folder, dump folder, just a folder I create to put some stuff in that needs to be processed. And this time around, what needs to be processed is all the tracks I just introduced to my collection, which, let's see, that is up to there. Like I said, it were not just the 40 tracks, I already introduced some other stuff to the collection, a total of 1 to 56 tracks that will be the base of my operanda. These are all in the dump folder right now. And what I can do is, I can, for instance, set mixed in key to work already to process those tracks, which is a little bit tricky because I also need the Traktor, but hey, let's see what we can do. For now, I'm going to fire up the next app in the workflow, that is the Traktor iTunes Merge Playlist, TIMP for short. And what this tool does is simply allow me to say, I want that playlist part of iTunes, period. I forgot something, by the way. Mr. Pass, I'm going to look at your question in a moment. Let me put this to work first, because I know this is going to take some time, which means I've got all the time in the world to answer your question. And I appreciate your question, so let them come, please. Let's double check what I just did on what is top 40 shit and what is not. We can see that right there, because I needed to add this stuff to my overall dense folder, which I didn't yet. So let's do that right here. So I'm totally set up. That should be there. And this is semi-commercial stuff. So let's put it right there. That means I should be good. Let's see. Yeah, I'm good. So that was just some housekeeping I needed to do. Let me put TIMP to work, because then I got all the time to ask, to have a look at Mr. Paul's his question, and to see if I can say something meaningful to it or not. We'll see. It's always something you have to look at. You can see automatically it recognizes that the 3.42 collection is used. I disabled the beta 3.5 for now, because 3.5 is beta and I'm playing with it. Actually, I made some apps for it already, but my main collection is still in the stable official release 3.42, so that's why I disabled it. And you can see right here that the iTunes library XML is used as a base. Let me double check that that is indeed the iTunes XML that was just created by iTunes automatically, which it is right there. So that means we are good to go. And you can see here which metadata I also want to sync to Traktor. Remember, some metadata is not a common tag. That means that that metadata is only stored in the database of, for instance, iTunes, and not in the tags of the audio files. That is the case with star rating, date edit, playka. All that kind of shit is not in the tag. So I want to add them as well to my Traktor collection or change them if they are changed. And that is where you see why you see those metadata stuff. Artwork, etc. are common tags. Those are always be known. Let's hit start conversion and let's take a close look at what Mr. Paz asked me. I also have a very big collection, similar size, as like to be ready for requests at mobile events. I'm working on a better, easily manageable system, but it isn't likely that I will trim my collection very much, just better organize it. As for streaming, I can't see the types of venues like hotels having a reliable internet connection for a long while here in Wales, the UK, and some bars maybe, but not many venues for mobile events. I think, Mr. Paz, that even those hotels, etc., will have that reliable internet connection, even if it is in the outer rims, because if you organize a wedding, then everybody on the wedding wants to make selfies and stuff like that, which means they have to have a reliable internet connection, like it or not. So that will be there, and maybe not right now, but next year 5G will be rolled out. It is already being rolled out in the Netherlands, but it's still operating on the 4G network. So it is the 5G spectrum reduced to 4G. But when 5G is fully operational, then you've got a tremendous bandwidth with very flexible internet availability. And at that moment, I think every spot in the world where you want to create, where you want to do an event, like a wedding, will have a reliable internet connection. Like, trust me, it will happen, and it will happen fast. Not for us DJs, we just benefit from it. No, it will happen for the people who are going to the party because they want to do their Instagram stuff, etc. All right, let me instruct, because here you see my iTunes collection again. Let me instruct Timp what I want to do. So I want to have, and that was the reason why you saw me quickly make some changes to my Dance 2021 place. I want to have this one, that one, and that one. And then we just introduce some stuff to the Top 40 2021, like there. Those playlists I want to introduce to my Traktor collection, and I say go, and I can get back to whatever questions you guys have, because this will take a while. Yeah, 5G, Mr. Paz, will be indeed the deciding factor about availability. I don't rely on hotel Wi-Fi and stuff like that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about self-sustainable internet, which means as a DJ, you will have your own 5G hub. You just plug it in and everything will run off 5G. If you look at, for instance, how the Denon Prime gear that is right beside me can work with Dropbox already, that is a beautiful integration. Pioneer DJ are my friends, let me say that first. I work very close with them with all the apps I develop, but I don't like the way they did the cloud integration. I think that is just too cumbersome with your tracks separated from the metadata and one part in the Pioneer DJ cloud and one part, that's not how things should work. Denon got it with the Dropbox integration. It basically comes down to sync your Dropbox folder from your computer, log into your Prime gear, and you have everything at your fingertips. And I think that is the way the future will look, that very soon, also from Pioneer, we will just have gear. You log into that gear and you have all your tracks there, period. No USBs, no drives, no nothing. Everything will be in the cloud. And at that moment, you will also see the power of audio streaming services, because that will piggyback on that development, like it already does with a lot of stuff. So I think that that is the future, but not right now. I think we are 1 to 2 years away from that. But because, hey, I can afford it. I am at the cutting edge of these technologies. I already developed an app that can convert your cues and loops. You set, for instance, on Serato on a Beatport link to Denon Prime. So you only have to set them once, like everything I like to do only once, and then convert it out. That stuff I have already written. So I'm now waiting just for the general DJ public to basically endorse it. Check your iTunes merge playlist is done. And if you played close attention, you saw it unmounting the terabyte. And that is a little trick because, where am I? There am I. Because if you have a very big collection in Traktor, like all those 112,000 tracks are in Traktor as well, Traktor takes forever to start up. It is already trying to start up because you can see that right here, but this takes forever to start up. I found out that if your tracks are externally stored, like my tracks are on my terabyte, and you unmount that drive before you start up Traktor, Traktor will start up quicker. It won't be a speed demon, so it is not like it will start up in 30 seconds instead of 20 minutes, but it will start up quicker, and that is the reason why you saw my terabyte disappear. Let me mount it right back because I really need that one, like this. So there it is, you can see it right there. And let me just quickly tell you what has happened, because you see this analyze these first playlist. That playlist is created by Timp. Those are the tracks that were introduced to the Traktor collection, but not already part of the Traktor collection. You can see it right there with an exclamation mark because they were not found. Let me just select all those tracks and put Traktor to work like this. Where am I? Check consistency. Mr. Pals, great information, Mixmaster G. The future is exciting and frightening at the same time. I'm not sure how much I will be able to embrace of these changes. I'm a little bit old school, but always interested in tech developments. I am the definition of old school, Mr. Pass. So I hear what you're saying, and I know that we are always reluctant as DJs to embrace new technologies, but this will happen with or without us, like it or like it not. And the downside of that is that a lot of events that now have a DJ will get, like it or not, an AI playlist. And you can say, well, an AI playlist can never substitute for a real DJ. I'm afraid that for a lot of events it will, but not for all, and it is still a craft. So a DJ that has the craft and knows how to read a crowd and knows how to pick the right track at the right moment will always beat an AI. I'm sure about that. But for a lot of events, and you can see that happening already, the Spotify playlist will take over, like it or not. It is what it is. There are a lot of crafts that are not in the world anymore, simply because they were replaced by other technologies. And I'm afraid that for some parts, the DJ craft will be at the same level. Like, and again, not because I like that. I'm afraid that is just the way things are. While Traktor is working, I'm going to open Mixing Key 10, and I'm going to make sure that my preferences are set off entirely, which means I don't update any text. You can see that right there. I don't export any cue points, also not to Rekordbox, please. I don't rename any files. You see that everything is just basically set to defaults. And I did quit it, which wasn't really what I wanted. I can quit Quicksilver because I don't need any keyboard shortcuts. But I really need Mixing Key to be open. And then I'm going to open my iTunes. And remember that dump folder that I created. And that dump folder is now very important for me because I want to have all that information. You can see it is, you cannot see that because it is on my other screen, because right here it says 156 tracks. So basically five tracks were already in the collection and were not added to the Traktor collection. So that is the difference between the 151. Oh, it says 156 even, right? 156 there and 156, which you can't see because my head is in front of it, but at the other side. All right, I can quit iTunes again there because I don't need it anymore. Mixing Key will start analyzing. It is already working analyzing. Apologies if the stream is going to skip a little bit because MixNiKey is notorious for eating up bandwidth, and not only bandwidth but also CPU cycles. So sometimes that will influence the way this works. What is important for me to know right here is what the ID is about what the latest tracks were that were introduced. And for that I sort on import date. You can see that right there. You can see right here a diversion between yesterday and today, because I already did parts of this yesterday because there was really a lot of work that I needed to introduce. And you can see it by the command field. These are the command fields that are yet created by another app of mine, the Traktor Q and Key tool, which I will invoke in a moment. And that is what needs to be done later on. Let's see what MixNiKey has to do. No, I don't want this. And the MixNiKey team knows about this bug. It is really annoying, but MixNiKey tries to write to Traktor, even if I said, don't write to Traktor. And it will warn me that it cannot write to Traktor because Traktor is open. They will fix that in the next release, they promised me. But what I want to know is this particular number. The what did I say? The 110244, because that is the track that is the latest track in it. Well, you are in luck, my friend, because this is exactly the question that I'm going to answer. DJ Topnotch 100 just asks me, all right, Mixmaster G, what is the best BPM detection software? You are looking at it, Traktor. Traktor is the best software for auto analysis of a static grid. Traktor doesn't work with dynamic grid. A dynamic grid is a track where the BPM fluctuates throughout the track, like old soul and old. Traktor cannot work with that. It can only work with one BPM level in the track. What Traktor can do is set the beat marker, the start of each bar, at different segments, but it can only contain one single BPM. But it is the best in it. And what you are going to see, DJ Topnotch, is how I use my Traktor collection right here, with the MixNiKey information that has just been analyzed using my tool, to produce something you will not believe. Because usually when you use MixNiKey and you let it make cue points, it will override all your existing cue points. This stuff will add MixNiKey cue points to existing cue points and loops, which means that you no longer lose the cues and loops you set. So what I do is I combine the best of all worlds. MixNiKey has the best key detection in the universe, for sure. Traktor has the best grid detection in the universe, for sure. My tool will use the grid and the BPM level set by Traktor and use the MixNiKey cues to combine that information. So basically I get the best of all the worlds without losing any information. Let's just take one track and just give it so you can see. Keep this in mind, the play track by Jax Jones. Let me make a screen cut of that so I don't forget that. Let's give that track a cue here quickly, and let's give it an auto loop there just quickly. Now, what is important? Hold on. That's not what I wanted. Throw it away. Let me play. Activate that loop. No. Not like this. Sorry, I'm a little bit rusty here. Let's put it right there. Because if you want to store a loop in Traktor, you have to play the track. Like that. So now that is stored. So I just gave it a cue and a loop, and you will see that that cue and loop will survive and will get the Traktor cue or the MixNiKey cues added to it. Very quickly, let me refresh your memory. What is a MixNiKey cue? MixNiKey analyzes for key, of course, and for energy level. Energy level is highly subjective, so it is not like energy level 8 for a drum and bass DJ is the same as energy level for an R&B DJ. Those are entirely different subjective things, but MixDKey just tries to give it a subjective integer number for energy level. While MixDKey analyzes for key, it also detects where the energy level in a track changes. And at those changes in energy level, it can set a cue. And those are the cues you can see from MixDKey. And you will see in a moment that my software will even take the energy level that was detected by MixDKey for the segment in the cue name, so you know what is going on there. Enough said, let me quit Traktor right here, because that can take close to forever. Again, the trick here is eject the drive that contains... Oh, the track is loaded, all right. Never mind, just quit Traktor, sit back, enjoy the ride. This can take a little bit of time before it is there. But we got the time. It is a Sunday after all. We just had the Eurovision Song Contest yesterday Eve. Congratulations to my Italian viewers, by the way. Italy won it with a track that I really didn't expect it to win. I always like to watch the Eurovision Song Contest, because on one hand it is pretty cheesy, but on the other hand it is for a DJ the ultimate test. Are you capable of predicting the taste of the general public about which song is going to win? And that is a little game I play since I was a very young kid. Just see, can I pick the winner before the winner is known? And usually I'm very good at it, but this year not so, because the track I picked was by friends, was the France track. I thought that would be first and Switzerland would be second. But Italy won with a hard rock track, to my surprise. But hey, a winner is a winner, right? All right, my Traktor is stopped, so I fire up the Traktor Cue and Key tool. The Traktor Cue and Key tool is basically the bridge between Traktor and MixDKey, and I can hear it think, hey, MixMasterD doesn't MixDKey right to Traktor itself. Yes, it does, but not to the level that I'm going to show you. Because, first of all, we are going to have MixDKey's merge with the existing keys, cues in Traktor. That is why I just set a cue in a loop there, so you can see what I mean by that. It will create a command field that is sortable. So what it will do is it will add a zero to keys below 10, with the value below 10, and it will add a zero in front of BPMs below 100. So you can make that command column totally sortable. Oh, thank you, Mr. Paz. Thank you. Yes, we... thank you. Yeah, we hosted it indeed. And it was fun. Oh, yeah, you're from the UK. No, it is not fishy. Mr. Paz, let's face this. We already knew this discussion was coming from the UK. This is fishy because there were no points given to the UK. There were no points given to the Netherlands as well. The Netherlands had the wrong song at the wrong moment, and I knew that from the beginning. And the same with the UK track. That was not a track you sent to a Eurovision Song Contest. It just wasn't good enough for that. Face it, like it or not. But the same is for the Dutch for the Dutch track. So I can say that safely, because I can say in the same breath, not only the UK track was bad, the Dutch one was bad too. So that makes it very easy. But 0 points is very harsh. But we also got 0 points from the public vote. So you are not alone in that, and there is a reason for that. And let's face it, I have a background in the financial world. I made my fortune on the stock exchange, and we have a saying there, the market is always right. And the same for this kind of stuff. The audience is always right. And there is nothing fishy about this, because it cannot be manipulated. You saw how big the swings can be the moment the public vote come in. Of course, the professional jury, you can say, all right, that is fishy. But the moment the general public, they just listen to the track and they say, that's the best track and that wins, period. And I never saw Italy winning. I knew that when it started, that they said, all right, Italy will win because it has had the most Spotify plays, which is a reliable indication, but I never saw that one winning. I saw France winning and Swiss second. I didn't like the Swiss song. I liked the France song, by the way. I didn't like the Swiss song. And my personal favorite, if you like, want to know, was the Ukraine. I really, really, that track was catchy as hell. So I really enjoyed the Ukraine track. Nobody in my family, and my own girlfriend, thought I was crazy liking that track. I really enjoyed the Ukraine track. That was my personal favorite. But hey, it is what it is, and Italy won. So kudos for Italy. Back to the subject. The Traktor Tune key tool. Remember that shortcut I made about where the new tracks are introduced. That was the shortcut of the track that I played with. This is the shortcut I was looking for. I can already see that number right here, but I wanted to make sure that that number is correct. You can see it is not entirely correct. So if I just enter this number here, that means that it will basically only process the tracks after that number there, which are okay. There is a little overlap in there. I'm fine with that. Just go ahead. So let's go back to the main settings. Let's put this to work. Start conversion and sit back. This is on automatic. Let's see what Mr. Pass said. Yes, not a great night for both countries, but still enjoyable contest. Yeah, this was a pretty good contest. I cannot remember a year where there were so many tracks that were kind of a level I liked. Not that I said, all right, this is great, but at least digestible tracks. And there were quite a few of them. So good to see people coming together, being happy. Yeah, there was another, of course, that was a very important thing about this event too. For those of you, especially over in the States, this was the first time in Europe that there was a very big event. There were 3,500 live audience people there without face masks. They were allowed to cheer, to sing along, to do everything. Of course, everybody was screened, so you needed to have a proof that you didn't carry COVID, or you needed to have a proof that you were vaccinated. Everybody was tested before they entered there. But it is very, very, very important that these events are possible again, because this is the opening to the future, to what we want. So yeah, Iceland song was nice too. Iceland was the one that had a little bit of the Limp Bizkit kind of vibe in it, I thought. Malta was nice too. Malta was I called it Lizzo, was the Lizzo act. Russia, not that much. It was hyped a lot, but that really didn't resonate with me. Well, I'm usually very all about women's rights and things like that, but that just didn't catch me. It didn't resonate with me. We are back in Traktor, as you can see. And let's go back to the analysis first. And there we had the play track, and let me load it up. And you can see right now that we all of a sudden we've got a gazillion cues. This queue, and you see it by the name, TCK4Q, that means that it goes to an energy level of 4 inside the track. This is the queue I set manually, and you can see by the NN name that it was a manual set queue. You see the loop I set is still there, and the rest are, these are just queues coming from mixing key, and you can see the number between brackets are the numbers with the information. Now, if we go back to my playlists, and remember, those playlists originated on iTunes. I didn't put them in manually. They originated in iTunes, and just take a track, and you can see by the date that it was introduced, imported today, you'll see that indeed that also has information. Remember what I said about the command field. Look at these command field, folks. These are sortable right now, so you can now very quickly go from one key or one compatible track to another, very easily find if those tracks are compatible. I also like to put them in the display of my CDJ next to the track title. I like to put my command field so I know what my bass key is and my bass BPM before I play with pitch, fader, etc. So this is very valuable information. And this is all right now in my Traktor collection. So you can see the mixing key cues, which answers, or I hope answers, DJ Top Notch his question he had earlier on. There. And now I see something I really don't like to see. So let's see that I can very quickly move ahead of this, because I really hate it when I see spam appearing in my chat. So let's see if I can. That's one of the problems if you are just doing this all by yourself. Then sometimes you have to do stuff which you really cannot do. So I want to make sure that spam can be deleted from my. There it is. No, I didn't want to reply to it. I want to ban that. How can I do that? Not like that, not like that. Oh man, I'm getting too old for this one. I need mods, but I'm too small a player to have mods. I totally understand it. Why can I not show moderation actions? Yeah, I want to see moderation action. Why can I not see the moderation actions? Oh, I need to switch to mod set. Oh, I was there. Switch to non-mod set. Now I want to be in the mod settings. I want to be there. Whisper add, no. Mod commands, ban. Oh yeah, ban. All right. And we are banned. Don't you love that? I can do that. Yay, we can do that. We got power. So that has been banned. Thank you. Sorry for that, folks, but I just saw that happening in the chat, so I wanted to make sure that individual was banned from my channel. They most likely will return by another name, I know that, but hey, that's just me. So I've got all the information in my Traktor collection, and what I'm going to do right now is the part most of you might be interested in. I'm going to convert this information to Rekordbox, to Serato, to Algorithms DJ, to Virtual DJ, and to Denon Prime. And for that, I just need the collection file to be complete, and that means I have to export it like this to an NML file, which takes a little bit of time. And let's wait for it to finish. This is the part where I've got plenty of time to talk to you guys if you've got questions, because these are all actions that will set into motion, and then we just sit and wait. Usually if I do this stuff, I just walk around. I have different stuff to do, and I just wait. I just initiate it, and I walk away, and I walk back, and I see if it's finished. But hey, because we do this in a live stream, and I try to explain to you guys if there are questions, we just have to sit and wait for it to finish. And for some reason, sometimes Traktor can be very slow at the, you see that the last part, it is very slow. It will finish, I know that, I know my Traktor, but hey, it can be slow sometimes. And well, that's just the way things are. I just happen to like my Traktor for the reasons I explained to you guys before. Basically legacy is by far the biggest determining factor, and the fact that it has the best grid analysis in the industry, those two, but legacy by far the most important one, because let's face it, it is not like the others have a bad bit grid detection. I think at this moment, if you really have to look at it, Algorithms DJ has the very best grid detection. However, that cannot be converted, and there is some stuff they do with it. It is great, but you cannot use it beyond Algorithms DJ, and I want to use my information beyond the initial stuff. So that's the reason why, hey, Traktor it is. And we just wait for Traktor to finish. I just gave it the quit command, and it is trying to quit, trust me, and it will quit in a moment. But hey, this can take some time, so we wait for that. Why not? And for those interested, you can drop your questions in the chat. There we are. And the moment, this one, this wasn't script. This was just strictly coincidental. Let me just delete those two and fire up the DJ conversion utility. There it is. And we tell it we come from Traktor. And now I'm going to do a little trick. So bear with me and think with me. Because iTunes is still the base of all my operation, all my DJ software uses tracks that are uses the playlists that are stored in iTunes. That means I'm not going to select any playlists because those are in iTunes. What I'm going to select are the tracks I introduced to the collection today, which means I'm going to use this option. I'm going to use to only convert tracks that were added today. I could also select tracks that were modified today. I'm not going to do it. I just take the tracks that were added today because yesterday I already run it with the modified tracks. And yesterday I already imported the information from my Denon Prime drives back to my Traktor collection. So that is all up to speed. The only thing I really need to do right now is just convert that information. Basically, it comes down to the grid that Traktor created or analyzed, and the mixed key information that is set on top of that. So that is what we are going to do now. And we are going to wait for to finish. Like I said, this is the stage where there is a lot of waiting involved. So if you just have questions, drop them in the chat and I'm happy to answer them, because there will be a lot of waiting around this part. But I will show you the results of it, so you will still have an idea of what has happened here. We can still talk about the song, the Eurovision Song Contest, because hey, that was this last night and it was fun to watch. It really was fun to watch. You see those same 156 new tracks, because those were tracks introduced. We are going to Recordbox, and for those of you who follow me, Recordbox past version 5.6.0 has a bug. And that bug prevents it from importing XML data unless you use a special procedure. It can be circumvented, but it will be slow. For me, because Recordbox is not my base DJ software, Traktor is, and because I only need Recordbox to create CDJ USBs as a backup, I stick to Recordbox 5.6.0 because that doesn't have the XML import bug. Now, what does that mean? This Recordbox collection is huge. Let me show you how huge. Let me turn this off, make this a little bit smaller. Let's select all the tracks in it, and then you can see those same 120,000 tracks are in Recordbox. So this is a very, very big Recordbox collection. This show. That also means that if you import XML information, it will take close to forever. Right here you can see the XML that was just produced. Let me just, what I always do before I start the import is just double check, is the information after the conversion the thing I want it to be. So let's take that play track again by Jax Jones, because hey, that's the one we used. And let's load it up. And you can see how long this takes to load in a track in the deck. It is taking forever. Pioneer DJ is fully aware of this behavior, that the moment the collection becomes big, it becomes a problem to import that information in the collection. And here you see very beautifully what has happened. We have the TCK queues. Those are the queues set from MixNiki by the Traktor Queue and Key tool. Those are purple, and that is the reason for that. I can dive into that as well, because usually you don't have colors in Traktor, but I made a little app that makes it possible to assign colors to a certain queue name. You can see that catch loop I set is still there, and I see there is a little bit of a shift in the grid that is most likely an MP3 shift. Not very nice, so I can fix that later on. Something to just keep in mind. But hey, we are just doing this stuff right now. So what I need to do is import all this information inside my record box collection. So I just say import playlist, and I can only do this because this is record box 5.6.0, but I'm not going to wait for this. You can see it is initiated. You see we are at 0%, but I just hide this in the back, and this will be running in the back throughout the rest of the stream, because those MER 1 to 56 tracks I want to import in my recordbox XML on a very fast computer, I might add, it will take most likely close to 2 hours to import, and that is just because of recordbox. There is nothing I can do about that. But we can go to the next stage, which means conversion to recordbox, or conversion to Serato, Virtual DJ and Algorithms DJ. But before I go to Algorithms DJ, I need to make sure that the tracks are analyzed in DJ. So for that, I fire up Algorithms DJ, like this. Wait for it to open up. Again, it might be a little bit sluggish because Recordbox in the back is importing all this information. I've got OBS open to upstream the information, or upstream the video to the streaming computer. So there's a lot of going on this computer right now. Remember, I created that dump playlist and I put in all the tracks that I wanted to be, that were basically introduced to the collection. This is one of the reasons why I did, because now I can select it. You can see one of the 56 tracks are in it. I can just say analyze songs. And this will guarantee me that all the tracks that were introduced to the iTunes collection are analyzed in DJ. And they need to be analyzed in DJ in order to receive their cues and loops from the converted data. So that's just a little something, a little shortcut I'm taking, if you like. They are analyzed. That means I'm good to go. I'm firing up the DJ conversion utility again. And this time we take the Recordbox XML that was produced in the conversion from Traktor to Recordbox as a source. So I'm going to, from a Recordbox collection, and you can see it automatically select that DJCU XML right there. I say I want to go to Serato, I want to go to Algorithms DJ, and I want to go to Virtual DJ, like this, and just hit start conversion. It will ask me what I want to convert, and that is basically that one single playlist named tracks added at or after today. And that's it. Sit back, enjoy the show. Will take a while, and then all the information is converted to Algorithms DJ, Virtual DJ, and Serato. And I'm out of my first bottle of water. It is a Sunday, which also means that we have an extended breakfast here at my own house, and that means you get a thirsty throat at the beginning of the evening, like right now. And if you've got questions, just drop them in the chat, because basically we are sitting and waiting here for this stuff to finish. And you can see what's happening. We are converting to Serato right now. And like I said, usually I don't do this and sit and wait for it, because it will be like watching paint dry or watching grass grow. Take whatever thing you want from that, because it can be very boring. But hey, we are through, like this. And let me show you. Yeah, that's okay. I don't need to see the log. You have been updated. How lovely. Okay, let's go. You can see all those apps were automatically opened. Let's go to that dump thing, and we've got the track named play, I think was our focus track, right? Why can't I see that? Right here. There we are. Let me find that track. This was the one, I think. Let me load it up, and you can see the cues are all there, and even the loop. Let me find the stored loop, the saved loop right there. You can see even the loop is there. So that information is exactly converted as you want it to be. So that's in DJ. Now if we go to Serato, or actually we are in Virtual DJ right here. Go away, please. Let's see. And then we take the playlist that was created there, and there we got the play track, and let me load it up for you again, and there you can see again those cues. And if we switch to the saved loops, you see that that saved loop is automatically there too. You can, one of the things of you see it being activated and deactivated like that. So that information is all converted. Remember, still coming from my Traktor collection, and there are some cool tricks you can do with it. Because for instance, I'm not sure if I can show that in DJ, because DJ has or not here. Let me double check this too. Let's find the play track. And then there it is. We don't have much mobile events. The clubs I played in, I was a mobile DJ for a very short time, because in those times you had what was called drive-in discos, which means basically there was a venue that wasn't really a bar or something, and you just put in the speakers and then the turntables, and that was each Friday night a party. But very soon I was lucky enough to have a residency at a regular discotheque, which has a booth with all the equipment. And that is the way in whole of Holland. If you play on regularly, the bar or the discotheque or the club has its own booth already installed, and that's basically it. So there, of course, there are mobile events with weddings and stuff like that, and that's an entirely different story, but I only know about the club scene, and I'm not very good at telling, all right, this or that. I can tell you that my DJM Nexus 900 right in front of me, right here, if you like, is my audio hub. This is what I use as my audio hub. In a moment I will move to my primes. I have an SC5000 with an X1800 by Denon mixer. I really don't like the Denon mixer. I don't like the Denon digital to audio conversion. It sounds like there is somebody standing in front of the tweeter. You miss something, some of the energy in the high end. So I use a Xone DB4 as my preferred mixer on that rig. So that is all very personal, but for live mixer for mobile events right now, and again, I'm not an expert in this. My lucky shot would be I think still a Pioneer RX or maybe a Rain 1, because those have pretty good DAs. I wouldn't recommend the Prime 4, though I love the Prime ecosystem, I love the Prime players, I love how the Prime 4 works, but I don't like the Denon DA. It just doesn't resonate with me, so that's why I wouldn't recommend a Prime 4, while I love the technology in it. So I would recommend an SC5000 with any mixer of your choice digitally connected to your players. It is a matter of taste, my friend. What I was going to show you guys was that if you look at the top 40 list, and again, this is coming straight from my iTunes collection. DJ Algorithms DJ is taking that information straight from the iTunes collection. And if we sort it on date edit, like this, and we take a random track like this, you can see that all the information is right there. So because all those tracks are stored on the terabyte on my central storage system, and because I use iTunes as my central playlist system, it really doesn't matter where I am accessing those playlists. If I converted the data from Traktor, all the tracks will have the information the moment I pull it up. And that is exactly what you see right here. Let's take a short look at how Rekordbox is doing. We are at track 41 and we already converted all those tracks over to Serato, Virtual DJ and Algorithms DJ. And on top of that, we are going to convert that to Denon Prime. And for that, I need my SSD. So let me get that SSD right here. There we are, because what we are going to do right now is close to magic. This is a 2 terabyte SSD drive. If you use the Denon Prime ecosystem, there is one factor that is holding you back, and that is the Engine Prime software, because basically they made a mess out of it. So for that reason, I created my own software that will just basically take all the information we have right now, so the Traktor data and the iTunes data, and put that on a drive that I can connect straight to my Denon Prime gear without using Engine Prime anywhere. The only thing I will do in Engine Prime is analyze those tracks, so we have the graphical representation of that track, and that's basically all that I will do, and after that it is off to the races. Now this is a very highly automated procedure, because what I need to do is, you see here the drive, I need to get the tracks from the terabyte on that drive, I need to convert the data from Traktor, and I need to make the playlists from iTunes. But we all automated that. And the center of all this is something called the iTunes Rekordbox Collection Backup Tool. And that is a backup tool I created specifically for Rekordbox / iTunes collections. You can use it either way. And the moment I start it up, you see that it recognizes the Rekordbox DJ Conversion Utility XML that was produced when I converted from Traktor to Rekordbox. So that will be used as a source. And it recognizes the Prime drive as my target drive. The moment I click Start Backup, the thing that will happen is it will copy the tracks to that target drive that are not already on that target drive or were modified. And it will create an XML that will work with it. After that, it will start up the Denon conversion utility, and that will take care of the conversion of the data. It is an automated process, so I just click Start Backup, and then I've got time to answer Mr. Paul's his question, which I will do in a moment. Hold on, there we go. Sit back, enjoy the ride. I'm torn between a Yamaha, Mackie, or Behringer, and the PV1 that Digital DJ Tips keep mentioning. I've heard very good things about the small Yamaha mixers. I have owned a Behringer mixer myself. It was just too noisy. It was like there was a wind blowing inside of it. So I cannot recommend those. My speakers are, you can see them maybe in the back, maybe I'll put a camera on it. I use Electro Voice active speakers as my monitors. Those are my studio monitors, but I just happen to be in the situation that I don't have any neighbors, so I can just...
The Denon conversion utility needs your attention.
Turn them up. This is, by the way, mid-procedure. I have to analyze those tracks that were just copied over, etc., to the drive. Those are in a special crate, and you will see that in a moment. It will open Engine Prime, and basically this is all automatic. Just follow the instructions on screen and we'll be good to go, which is entirely different from using Engine Prime and the sync manager and the problems you have if you want to import information from a Rekordbox collection and then you lose information, etc. Nothing like that. So right here you see this folder, analyze tracks first. Let me make this a little bit wider and get rid of it. These are the tracks that were just copied over, and it should say, indeed, 156 track, isn't that magic, it still remains the same thing. Select all those tracks, right click, say analyze tracks, sit back, it will start analyzing them. The moment this hits zero, I quit it, and the Denon conversion utility will pick up and continue. Let's see what Mr. Paz is saying. Alright, so I heard very good things about Yamaha's, they are affordable and pretty reliable, and I think those things and robust, and I think those things are very important. Like I said, I don't have very good experience with Behringer mixers. On the other hand, Behringer USB boxes are my default audio USBs. These little things. It's a UCA222. These are very affordable and very reliable audio to USB converters. For instance, the microphone I'm using right here, this is a Sennheiser wireless microphone.
It looks like Engine Prime is done analyzing. If that is the case, then quit Engine Prime now.
Yeah, I know, my friend. That microphone is connected through a Behringer USB box, so it is a separate audio channel from my 900 in my OBS. So if I do a live stream, I can record the audio without recording my voice over it. So I can separate those two. All right, the conversion utility is done. It will open Engine Prime again. Now let me show you what just has happened. Because like I said, this is close to magic. Here we've got the playlist. Let me find that track named Play again. Let's see, where is it? There it is. Load it in the deck. There you can see again the cues set in Traktor originally, mixed in key endorsed cues. And you can see that the loop is there too. Let's switch to loop. There's the saved loop. You see that loop is there too. That is still coming from a Traktor information and was partly introduced into my Engine Prime collection. Now, one thing is left because right now I've got the DJ metadata in Engine Prime already for all those tracks. What I don't have are the playlists from iTunes because it just created that flat playlist I created from Traktor. But we can fix that too because let's quit Engine Prime here. Let's fire up CBT again. Where am I? And this time I'm going to feed into it the iTunes music library XML, the XML that was used as a source. And remember, I used that as a source, by the way, as well for the Traktor iTunes merge playlist, the tool I used at the beginning of this stream to get the iTunes playlists into my Traktor collection. So let's do that. Why not? iTunes is right there. Let's take the iTunes library. You can see by the date there, 709, that was recently produced. Just drag it in there and you can see that right there, that is the iTunes symbol, so it recognizes it as an iTunes XML. Still the prime drive, let's go. Why I'm doing this is I don't need those tracks to be copied over to the drive. You can see this is going very fast because most of the tracks are already there, so it just goes through them. But I need the XML with the correct file path on that drive, and that is what this tool will do as well. So we just have to wait. Mr. Paz, it's awesome how you move between all the different DJ software. I could watch your streams for hours and learn so much. You are a top man, Mixmaster G. Really appreciate. Thank you, Mr. Paz. Thank you for your very kind words. And you are always welcome to watch my streams. That is the reason why I'm doing this stuff. The reason why I'm doing these workflow videos is just to give artists, DJs, ideas of how to tweak their own workflows. I'm not saying that I've got the best workflow in the business. I don't know. Nobody can say that because that is very personal. But I know I've got a structured way and there is a logic behind the structure, and I try to just pass that information on, and then you can make your own decisions of how you can create your own workflow with basically the blocks I'm giving you. And maybe you don't want to use any of that. That's all fine by me. I just try to share the knowledge, and that's basically what I'm trying to do here. This is running. I'm going to get myself a new bottle of water. What a coincidence, we have them just in the back. So, a new bottle of water. And I also do these streams, to be honest, just to beta test all the apps I develop. Especially, there are some very big changes going to be made in the Denon conversion utility and in the collection backup tool. That is the reason why if you watch this stream back, you might think, hey, I don't have that version. That is entirely different version number than I have on my system. Yeah, there are some big changes coming, and that is the reason I want to make sure that everything still works in the old situation and in the new situation. And right now you're watching the old situation with the new apps. So don't you like that? Yeah, it is really great. So that's why I'm doing this stuff. And I just like to spread my knowledge to everybody who can take benefit or advantage from it. Why not? While this is running, and I'll keep that running, I can move the camera back to the, like this, because right here we've got the Denon rig. Let me power one of the players up, and let me tweak the camera a little bit. We now got, I just treated myself to a new cam, as you can see right here. Let's make sure that we've got everything. This is a second Sony ZV-1 you are watching, which is really a very nice cam, as you can see. So that is powered up already. Maybe I should center it a little bit. We have to wait anyway, so. Like this. Why not? Even a little bit more. This is all live and happening, so like this. So that is set up so I can connect the drive when this is all done. Now what basically has happened is that the collection backup tool created an XML that I can use in the Denon conversion utility as a source. And if I fire up the Denon conversion utility, you will see that it automatically selects that iTunes Music Library XML as a source. You can see that right here. And that is on the Prime drive, as you can see. That is just created by the collection backup tool. And you can see that the Denon conversion utility is running right here in iTunes compatibility. Keep the protection on, because all I need to do in this stage is create playlists. Is create playlists with the correct information. And that is what we will do right here. So again, we just have to sit and wait for this to process, and once it's processed, then we should be good to go. And that means we are close to the end of this stream. Let me double check. I warned you guys, right? This will take a moment or two to import. So Rekordbox is still importing and digesting that information. But in the meantime, I did convert to everything else. And that is the reason why I really think that Pioneer DJ should fix the XML import phase in Rekordbox, because let's face it, the XML is the only way you can enter the Pioneer DJ ecosystem if you come from different DJ software. So you would think they might make that as easy as possible, make that barrier to entry as low as possible, so everybody can very quickly and very easily enter into a Rekordbox, for instance. But hey, it still needs to be fixed after, I think, 2-3 years that I already talked about this. And the parsing playlist can take some time, because you can see that this, you see it says right here 256 out of 1078. This is most likely the dense dossier playlist, which is very big track-wise, not very much playlist, but very big track-wise, and then you see it just shooting through. You see it there happening, then it will be very quick again. So then it will pick up from there. And then waiting for the final one, this top 40s playlist folder, which is also a big one. So that will take some time too. And then it will shoot through, and then we can make selections. And that will be fairly quick, by the way, because that will just be creating playlists. This can be gone, that can be gone, that can be gone. That can be gone. Then we go to the dance 2021s. Where am I? There am I. That and that I want to have. And then I go all the way to the down to the top 4021. And those are the playlists I want to be created in Engine Prime on the drive. Just waiting for it to finish. This, like I said, this will be fairly quick. And then comes the real beauty of this whole system, because I can take that Prime drive you see right here. Maybe you can take that Prime drive, eject it, connect it to my Prime player, and you will see that all the information is there. The very first DJ gear, that was Traktor, back on the Apple Macintosh G3 computers without any controller at all. So I just used, and that was named Traktor Studio, I think, the first version. And I remember how amazed I was about that stuff working, because I only had vinyl back in those days. I had the same 1200s right behind me with a big analog mixer. And that was my base of operandi. And then all of a sudden there was this software that was capable of doing what I was doing on those tracks with MP3s. And MP3s were not very big in those days either. Those were just upcoming as well. So those were very interesting times for me. And after I adopted Traktor, the Vestax VCI 100 was my first controller, my first Traktor controller. And after that came the DDG-T1, which was a Pioneer Traktor specific controller with full-size jog wheels. And I still think they should bring that back to the market, because Traktor really needs a full-size jog wheel. But hey, I was talking about you guys, and going to show you guys, go away, how marvelous this system is, because this is really truly remarkable. I ejected the drive. Let me switch to my gear. There we are with the drive. Let me hook it up. Like that. And you can see what the power is of this, because I didn't need to prepare a drive like you need to do in record books. Everything is already there. I can access it directly on my, and that means that drive, that is a 2 terabyte SSD drive, contains all the tracks in my Traktor collection. It's not just the ATGR necessities folder, which is usually only on my CDJ USB. This thing contains everything. So let's see if I can find. And this is, and then we can find the play track. Let's do it on that, like this. You can see the star ratings are there. We still cannot change star ratings on the deck. I really would love to see that possible, but I can load that play track, for instance, like this. There you can see that the hot cues are loaded. And the loop is there. And even if I dive deeper into my top 40, like that, and go all the way down to the 2021 track, like that, and can we date edit like this, and then go to the top of it, like this, and there you can see the tracks. I hope it is readable, but those are the tracks that were just introduced to the collection, all from my iTunes collection and all from my base Traktor collection and straight to this drive. So this drive contains basically everything ready to roll. I think that is pretty powerful stuff there. And that also makes me come to the end of this stream, because like I said, record box is still working in the back. It is still importing, and it most likely is going to do that for the next hour or so. But hey, my work is done here. I'm not going to wait for Racketbox to finish. I'll let it finish completely and then double check my stuff. But I'm not going to bore you guys with that. which means I'm going to finish this particular stream. I do these kind of streams every Tuesday at 7 o'clock, where I just answer questions that I collected over the week from users of my tools. And I also answer, of course, questions people have in the chat, so you can just drop your questions just like now in the chat, and I'm very happy to do that. I see that DDT1 with the K3, I think that's a little bit steep price-wise. I sold my T1 recently, actually, because I just found it again and thought, hey, maybe somebody can be happy with it for, I think, 250 euros. So 350 pounds is a little bit steep. The problem with the T1 is it has only four active queues on a row. So you always need something to set extra queues. I use, for instance, I can take one of them right here. Let me disconnect it. These are Core nanopads, and I mapped them to Traktor, and I used them at the DVS kit right behind me. Each deck has its own Core nanopad, as you might see. And you really need those with T1, because T1 only has those four queues. But it is a capable, system. But 350, I think that is just too steep for it. I would say 200 pounds tops, and keep the flight case if you don't want it, because I'm not, you could see, maybe you saw that everything I use is in coffins. So I use a Swan Lake or Swan Flight coffins for every gear I use. But for a controller, I wouldn't matter for a flight case. It's just throw it in, that should be fine. Was me a pleasure, Mr. Paz, having you in the stream. Thank you for joining. Like I said, I do this every Tuesday, 7 o'clock Central European time, so always feel free to join me. Then the stream is on Twitch, on Facebook, and on YouTube, like it is right now. This stream will be available as a video on demand on the YouTube channel, and it will stay on the Twitch channel for 14 days, like most likely, if it survives that long. I'm going to see who we are going to rate, because I promised my friend Cleveland Terry that no matter what you do and no matter how little the viewers are, always rate to the next guy. So let's see who is on. For those of you on Facebook or YouTube, thank you for watching already. I'm going to to disconnect that stream, because last time I rated, there was some audio on, and I immediately got a copyright strike by both Facebook and YouTube. So before I going to rate, I'm going to turn that off. Thank you for watching.